I had this little spiel that I was giving them. And basically what I was saying is, hey, if you're in a leadership position and you're not sure what to do, what you got to do in that situation, you got to guess. And then I'd go off about guess. I'd say, listen, everybody, no one wants to hear the word guess. Like, hey, Dave, you're in charge. What do you want me to do? Oh, let me take a guess. No one wants to hear that. That sounds horrible. No, who wants to follow somebody that I guess we should? Have you ever heard a leader in your life that was inspiring with you, with confidence when they said, hey, I'm guessing we should go over there? You don't say that as a leader. You don't use those words. And yet, and then I follow it up and say, but when you're in a leadership position, when you are making a decision, what you're calling a decision, it is a guess. And what the Marine Corps did here, because they didn't want to use the word guess, they sent us up into the next level and just called it a hypothesis.
Well, that's what that is.
Which is a guess.
Educated guess.
Which is an educated guess, which is still a guess.
Yes, sir.
But the amount of times that you are in a leadership position where you know for certain what's going to happen next is 0.0001%, because we can't predict the future. We don't know what all these little variables are, how all these little variables are going to turn out. So that's what we're doing as leaders, is we're making guesses. We're making hypotheses. We're taking, what you say, educated guesses.
Educated guess.
That's like in between, right? A guess is just a guess. An educated guess, next level, hypothesis.
Yes, sir. Yep.
So we've got to understand that. We understand that that decision is a hypothesis that gets tested in the real world when we actually act. The campaigning mindset then includes the understanding that we base our plans on a model we created of our competitor. Okay? Our decisions about how to achieve our goals in competition are theories. They're guesses. A lot of guesswork going on. And what's what I like about using the word guess, what I like about that is I think, you know, Dave, you were talking earlier about hesitation if you're making a decision-making process. Well, if I'm a young leader and I'm looking at my options A, B, or C, and I'm not sure which one to do, I might be thinking in my mind, well, what am I supposed to do? Just guess? Am I supposed to just take an educated guess with what we should do right now? I got all these resources. I got maybe lives at stake, or I got capital at stake. I got all these things going on. I don't feel comfortable just guessing, so I'm just going to sit here. I'm just going to sit here and wait, because I'm scared. Because it doesn't seem right that I should be guessing what to do. Yes, you should. Now, what I recommend you do is you guess little. Just take a little guess. Hey, should I go in door A, B, or C? You know what I'm going to do immediately? Hey, I'm going to walk up to that door and take a listen. What do I hear in there? Right? Is there a party going on, or is there gunfire? So, or is there no noise? Now, no noise I'm a little scared about, but if I hear music, that's kind of a positive sign. But I didn't enter the door. All I did was put my ear up to it. So that's what you do. You make a little guess. I guess we should check out that door. I hear gunfire. That doesn't sound like a good door. What about the next door? I hear nothing. Not sure about that one. What about this door over here? I hear music. I hear music that Echo Charles plays in his vehicle from the islands, which means everyone in that room is kind of cruising. And I'm feeling pretty good about it.
Yes.
We're opening that door, no factor.
Yep.
So if you're not comfortable taking a guess, then it's hard to make a decision. Our plans then need to have feedback loops built into them to either confirm that our models and theories are correct enough to help us reach our goals, or that we need to modify them. And by the way, they don't bring this back up to humility. They should. Because if you're not humble and you think, I'm guessing door C, and you walk up to it, you hear gunshots, you're like, well, I guess C, we're going in. Bad idea. So it takes humility to modify your plan. And if you're not humble, you won't be modifying your plan. You'll be sticking with your plan until it kills you. Competition campaigning introduces the idea of persistence. Strategic competition is more like a marathon than a sprint. Competition's enduring nature means that any campaign will require long-term commitment to achieve its goals. We also need to be alert for how our competitive advantages and those of our rivals will shift over time. This is what's scary about wars like Iraq, Afghanistan, Vietnam, where your enemy is home. They're not on deployment. They're going to be there. And when the wars, they'll wait, they'll be there for 100 years. There's not an American that wants to be there. There's not an American that's, hey, I'm stoked. I'm in Al-Qaim. Hey, I'm stoked. I'm in Qut. Hey, I'm stoked. Wherever. They want to be back in Nebraska. They want to be back in Iowa. But the people that we're fighting against, they are home. So before you get into that combat, you got to figure out who's got the home field advantage. It's a big deal. It's a way bigger deal than it is in sports. Mm-hmm. This next section is professionalism. As military professionals charged with the defense of the nation, Marine leaders must be true experts in the conduct of war. This statement from Warfighting One, the MCDP One Warfighting, establishes the first priority for Marines, which is to defend the nation. As professionals, Marines recognize this defense as a vital and enduring national interest. Our professionalism is grounded in our nation's values, which sets us apart from competitors. Achieving that standard, being prepared to defend the nation, has been and will continue to be a competitive act. So us just being ready is how we are helping America compete with everybody else in the world, because they got to keep up. And you see what the Marine Corps is doing, you know you better be training hard. We accept that the existence of the Marine Corps helps deter potential foes. Our goal is for that deterrence to take place below the violence threshold. So what we're doing right there, we're kind of making sure that even the doves in the government are looking at the Marine Corps thinking, you know, the Marine Corps doesn't want war either. The Marine Corps wants peace. They want these things to happen below. We better give them more money. Well-funded Marine Corps. Professionals understand this goal and thus direct their energies, self-study and unit development in particular, toward achieving it. So all Marines are trying to become professionals. Professionals. True experts in the conduct of war. As professionals, we recognize that development of coercive tools must be balanced with the need to attract in competition as well. For example, one component of an attraction strategy could lead to greater deterrence through building increased interoperability with an ally. It could also lead to advances through the informal element of national power as we perform disaster relief mission. Marines must remain alert for the opportunities to use and integrate both coercion and attraction into the larger competition. So the Marine Corps is not, they're saying here, we're not just here to fight wars. We're here to build relationships. Now at Echelon Front, we talk about building relationships all the time. That's how you lead. You lead by building relationships. That's how you get things done, by building relationships. And what we're talking about here is we are competing. And in order to compete, guess what we do? We build relationships. We build relationships. And just to give people an example, and I'm sure you have some more, Dave, but especially before the war started for me in the 90s, this is what the SEAL teams did. Go to a country, train their special operations unit, do a big exercise, train them in the use of our weapons. We train in the use of their weapons. We send some people to learn how to speak their language. We bring some people to learn that they can learn how to speak English. We form these relationships. We work together. So that way, we're strengthening our allies. We have somebody we can rely upon. We get to know them better. That's just relationships. That's what it is. Did you guys do that in the pilot world?
Yeah, I mean, I'm thinking about carrier deployments. And I think right now there's a connotation that the aircraft carrier, and it's probably already always existed, but certainly now since, you know, post 9/11, the carrier is this power projection tool, this, you know, 90,000 tons of diplomacy, you know, sovereign U.S. soil all over the world. They have these great taglines that the Navy leverages, which are true in a lot of ways. But pre-9/11, if you ever did a cruise pre-9/11 like I did back in the day, the joke, we called them pleasure cruises. It was like 13, 14 port calls. And the 2 months you know, that you sailed from San Diego to the Persian Gulf was a bunch of port calls. You're doing joint operations with different countries. You're pulling up Pearside and contributing to their economy. You're building all those relationships, and most of it is allies or people we want to build relationships with. Then you go to the Gulf for a couple months, do that thing. And in that, you're doing three or four port calls to Bahrain, to the UAE, all these places where we're trying to strengthen relationships. And that the carrier wasn't an instrument of power projection. It was an instrument of diplomacy, which was building those relationships. Obviously, post 9/11, you know, my experience, my second cruise was like, go to the North Arabian Gulf, stay there for 7 months, come home. But you know, before that, the investment the Navy was making was mostly strengthening the relationships. And there are stories out there, even somewhat recently, that carriers would deploy for disaster relief with no aircraft on them just to send a carrier to help, you know, floods and crazy things that happen in different places, strictly for strengthening ties and relationships that are projecting literal no combat power by design, because the Navy sea, well, I'm sure it's larger than just the Navy, but that's my connection. And, you know, I deployed off carriers for the most part.
Now so that's attraction, right? That's attraction as opposed to deterrence, right?
Yeah.
We're just trying to show people that, hey, you want to be friends with us.
Yeah.
We're attractive. We can help you if you get into a time of need.
We're a good ally.
At a tactical level, when I would deploy in the 90s, back in the day, we would go out and do exercises where I would be in the jungle with some special operations unit from some other country. What do you do when you are a fighter pilot?
Same thing.
Are you giving them a tour? Are you taking them in the backseat? Like, at a tactical level, just out of my own curiosity, what would you do?
You're flying with them. You're spending time with them. And there's a little
bit. Wait. Are they flying their aircraft? Yep. And so they're your wingman and you work some stuff.
Yeah, you're integrating with them. Sometimes you fight against them. Sometimes you fight with them. Really what it's supposed to be is kind of
this. Did you ever put your ego in check and let one of these foreigners beat you in a dogfight?
No, dude. Come on, man.
0% chance.
Zero. Now, certain countries, they would have. We would fly with different countries that they would have different ROE, different rules, training rules and things like that. And you could see some of them were geared very specifically to make sure that certain people had advantages. And we would play by those rules and sometimes get in trouble for not following those rules. You know, one of the things that's really cool about the American military, and certainly in aviation, and there's a saying we have, there's like, hey, there's no rank in the cockpit. So I could be the junior dude in the squadron. I'm not saying this happened very often, but you could be a mid-level guy. You're going to go out fly with your boss. And once you start fighting him, like, you can pummel him to just pummel him into the ground. And it's there is no, like, deference. Like, I don't want to make the old man look bad. You go out there and do your thing. That's not always like that. But the interaction, in some sense, was this idea that this American military with this big might, this big power, our aviation world is something they can learn from. But we always learned stuff from them, too. We would share briefing techniques and how they ran their briefs, how they trained their guys, how they did certain things. And a lot of it, at least on paper, was for us to bring to them things that could help them get better. But it was always reciprocal. We always learned from operating with other countries. And I flew with pilots and airplanes from all sorts of different countries, even sometimes the same exact airplane, but they fly it differently. They do things differently. So there's a whole bunch of things that you can do to interact with them that is beneficial for both. It was probably lopsided. What we knew and how we did it was usually more beneficial to them, but it wasn't completely one-sided either. Flying dissimilar with different countries is a blast because you learn stuff and go, oh man, we don't do that in our airplanes. That's really good for me to see. It makes me more prepared for if something actually really happens.
Would you guys go toe-to-toe Top Gun dogfight style, one-on-one?
Yeah, you'd have different things. I've never been in a situation where if the brief was you and me are going to fight, I don't care what country or what plane, once fight's on, it is game on. There is no like, hey, go easy on this guy or let this guy. I have never been in a dogfight once in my life. Other than, hey, I'm there to show you certain things. Mm-hmm. But if it's like a real dogfight, like just a real fight, you fly your best airplane. There are times that you would dial back your best jet because it'd be really, it would undermine the effectiveness of the training.
Of the relationship building as well.
But it never to like, oh, you did, you were, never
oh,
to.
Oh, good
to,
job. Yeah. You really caught me off guard there.
Yeah, yeah.
You got me.
That would be, you know, in the heyday of, when you're a Top Gun IP and you're fighting against somebody else and you're going to come back, no joke, you come back with 25, 30 valid shots. That can be really disheartening for somebody to look on paper and go, hey, let me see your shot card. And they've got zero shots. and you're like, oh, hang on, I need to get my second sheet of paper. And if